Gollancz presents The Devil's Blade, written by Mark Alder, read by Anna Bentinck. Paris, 1687. Prelude, Nocturne. They say the devil made her, but I know better. She told me all her stories, and I witnessed a few. Yes, I remember the night it began. I remember the night it ended, too, but I'll tell that tale another time. I had become interested in a certain group of gentlemen of great quality, and had heard they were planning to meet by midnight on All Hallows' Eve in the Bois de Boulogne, that deep, dark wood that leaks from the western edge of Paris like a pool of blood from a vanquished duelist's side. Now, this was the time of King Louis XIV, the Sun King, who very rightly spent his reign ignoring the poor and raising monuments to his own splendour. Neither he nor his police force, under the baleful rule of Monsieur de la Reynie, were interested at all in what happened beneath those trees, so long as it did not involve fermenting insurrection. It would have taken a brave revolutionary, or a lusty one, to visit the Bois at night, thronging as it was with whores and thieves and any other whose business proceeds better unseen. A man took his life in his hands to go there, and no woman of virtue would set foot beneath the trees, which was the point of these gentlemen choosing it for their little rendezvous, I think. These great men, you see, were lovers of frisson, of the charge that ignites the senses when mild danger is near, of pushing the edges of experience, of daring to do what others would not. Their idea of what that might entail might not be yours. It is probably a little extreme for your modern tastes. But let me just say that on a foggy autumn evening, when the moon hid her face, I can't really be bothered to paint the picture more clearly, you carry my drift, they had assembled with the noble intention of summoning the devil. As if you can summon the devil. That is an illusion fools have indulged in for centuries. You don't click your fingers and have hell come running. No, you make yourself interesting to hell. And then hell comes to look at you quite freely and of its own accord. First, of course, they did summon someone, the young woman, by sending a letter to her lodgings and asking her to sing for them. She was unique, you see, even then. Her voice so pure a soprano that such had not been heard on the Paris stage in living memory. Beauty like that from a girl of no professional training, delivered with the sort of innocence that so stiffens the dicks of men of dark tastes, could only be the work of God, they surmised. And what better way to delight the devil than to destroy one of God's rarer creations? They had brought her there to kill her, for sure, and in no pleasant way either, as we shall see. A virgin, an artist, a flower of God. Yes, how could Beelzebub refuse such a sacrifice? But let me present her not in a dry tale, told in this tawdry way. While I may not have the enthusiasm to describe the clinging fog, the torches in their veils of light, the deep smell of the horses, the wet autumn mud that encroached on the fine footwear of those gentlemen and threatened their pale stockings, I have nothing but enthusiasm for describing her. I will show you her, here, nervous and flushed, as she steps from the coach that has delivered her to the woods. She rearranges her skirts as she steps down, feels the cloth of the skirt to try to adjust a stray garter. She has to fight her instinct to simply lift up the dress and secure the garter herself. High men might be close. She needs to watch her manners. Of course, She would not have gone willingly into the woods. But she has not been looking out of the windows for reasons that will later emerge. She has no sense of what she might become, this girl of 16. She has not yet taken the grand name they will howl through their tears as they lower her coffin down into the dead earth, 2 or 3 times, as it happens. She was never very good at staying dead. For now, she is plain old Julie d'Aubigny, who has been panting by the door of the Grand Opera in Paris for a month in the hope of an audition. Her voice may be wonderful, but that is not enough. She needs introduction, presentation, the right people to speak for her. You might think, given her upbringing in Alsace, as the daughter of the secretary to the Comte d'Armagnac, that she would find such contacts easy to come by. But a secretary is a functionary, a tradesman really, and though the Comte might entrust the education of his sons and other pages to such a man, he would not speak to him beyond business. The Comte found Julie amusing when she was a younger girl, and laughed to see how her father had raised her as a boy among boys, teaching her to sing exquisitely, to dance very well, to fence well enough to beat the boys, and to draw with a steady hand and a curious eye. But one drunken attempt to fuck her when she was 14 aside, he has shown her little attention or interest since. She could not ask for his patronage without risking the sternest rebuke. So Julie has paid her way in the world by singing in the street, where she came to the notice of the Band of 13, the Black Tradicem, as they call themselves, in order, one presumes, to show they know Latin and are gentlemen. She was flattered when they invited her to sing for them. Such rich men, so much poise, so much refinement. Julie thinks these are men of influence. She is right. She thinks they might do her some good, get her the audition she seeks. She is dead wrong. But let me get on and tell this tale in the way she would have liked, as a drama, as an opera. Here, by torchlight, Act One. Enter Julie and Pavel, her lover, in a carriage. Act One. Scene One. The Chorus of the Diabolique. The torchlight is yet distant as she steps from the coach. The carriage they sent to fetch her has creaked and jumped its way over the potholes of the cinder road from the east gate to the woods, and then rattled along a little track to stop here. She kisses her companion, Pavel, to mark an end to their fun. He is a nice boy, who she met in her fruitless quest for an audition at the Grand Opera. He is the attendant on the stage door, running errands for Archon, the stage manager. If she is to sleep her way to the top, she has joked, she has left herself a long haul from these beginnings. Still, sometimes the long road is the most enjoyable, and Pavel is a dear. Pavel buttons his breeches as she exits the coach into the cold of the foggy night. She lifts her dough mask on its stick to her face, shifting her weight on her feet to stop her shoes sinking into the mud. These are her only pair, and she is mortally afraid of marking them. "Over there," says the coachman, "a footman will fetch you." Pavel is next to her now, searching for her hand, but she dismisses it. "Wait here," she says. "This is high company." He nods, smiles his big grin.
"So many mistakes to make with these aristos," he says. "Best have only one of us making them."
She kisses him once more, deeply, and he takes her head in his hands.
"I love you," he says.
"Don't do that," she says.
"Why not?"
I'm not made for it, she says. She almost believes it. Her plans don't involve love for a long time yet. And yet, Pavel is so kind and so warm. Could she love him? Perhaps, in a way she never thought she could love a mere man, but she must try not to. Men to her have always seemed too uncomplicated, too simple to love. You get things from men. Money, position, names, and the centre of their souls that lies in their breeches. You share things with women who are far more complex and interesting. Yet these simple qualities are what she has come to admire in Pavel. There is something else, though, that makes her warn Pavel away. She has always felt somewhat, she cannot quite put her finger on it, somewhat, well, dangerous, for want of a better word. Her life is to be an opera, a grand work, and lovers never fare well in those.
You want the audience to love you.
That is a different kind of love, she says. You are a love, Pavel.
I know you only hold back from me to lead me on.
Was I holding back in the carriage? He blushes, sweet boy.
Not like that.
Then, like what?
She comes close to him, still careful of her shoes in the mud, gives his dick a squeeze as she lowers her mask.
I've forgotten, he says, close by her mouth.
Well, tug on that until you remember, she says.
A light cough from behind her, like one of a lady's more demure spaniels, suggesting it might like another biscuit. She turns. A tripping servant, wigged, powdered, heavy with satin bows, comes towards her and takes her hand to lead her. She doesn't really like that. She knows she is only the same station as he, and that it is no affront to be led this way, but she does not want to appear as his equal among the great men she is to meet. One day, after her singing career is done, perhaps before, she will be a duchess. Julie may have been born poor, but she will die rich, whatever it takes. She rejects the man's hand, gives him a look.
Suit yourself, dear, he says,
and heads off up the track into the deeper woods. She collects herself, stands straight to her considerable height, and strides, following him along the track, humming a few scales under her breath. That is all she has ever needed for a warm-up. She was born to sing. Born singing, if you listen to her father. And she has been singing all her life. Warm-up? Her lovers say she sings in her sleep, and she has had enough of them to make a reliable jury. The wet smell of autumn chills her. The track is slippy, and she does her best to retain a good bearing as she walks along it. Head up, shoulders back, as if she is about to burst into song. She commands the stage of her imagination, as she is sure she will one day command the stage at the Grand Opera. These gentlemen she is to meet, the tradichem, as the group of patrons style themselves, are the gatekeepers of her future. She is met in a clearing by a group of four men who bear lanterns that make soft webs of light in the foggy air. They are masked, as is the fashion at soirees and balls. The theme they have chosen is unusual. The masks are all in the style of devils. She does not find it disconcerting. This is the high society to which she aspires. Masks, feathers, stomachers trimmed with gold and silver braid, emeralds, diamonds, rubies, things she has glimpsed as they flit between carriages and the gilded interiors she peeked into as a child. instinctively, she knows what she must give these men. The Comte's sons, before they went up to court, were as dirty, flea-ridden, and naive as she was. But she has learned enough from the men those boys became when they returned from the court and later from the war to understand them, at least a little. They do not have the sentimental tastes of the bourgeoisie. They favour the disturbing, the elegant, the challenging. It is here she will learn to belong. The gentleman devil who takes her arm to lead her further through the trees is perfumed with a rare violet scent and wears a coat of the silvered cloth they call gros de Naples, a lustrous silk inlaid with crimson half-moons. She has seen this cloth before only outside dressmakers, as it is delivered. And yes, she makes it her business to haunt such places, to know better how to furnish her dreams. Here, conjured from its long slumber on the roll, bid to rise and take life as a coat, the cloth transforms its wearer into a fabulous animal, a shimmering leopard who leads her to the magnificent court of the beasts. And what a court! 12 more men, all masked as devils, stand in a circle, each one a statue raised in tribute to excess, self-love, love of life. The torchlight makes deep pools in brilliant silk coats, glints from buckles and rings, turns the milled brass of a cane tip, shaped as a toad, to fire. It glitters from the jewels of the masks, sparkles from the gilded hilts and scabbards of their fine slim court swords. These are gentlemen, and they wear the latest weapons, short and slender blades. No lumbering long rapiers here, like the ones her father taught her to fence with. She tries to distinguish the men in some way, for if she meets them again, she could use this connection to her advantage. One has roses on his shoes, another an emerald ring that glints green even in the red light. One more has an uneven stance, one leg shorter than the other. Another has the monograph of a heart upon his coat. Still one more pats his friend's back and says, "Courage, Diablo!" Is that a name or a nickname? One of the men in the circle speaks. "This is the Virgin?" A voice, old and dry, with vowels so strange and clipped that Julie has to suppress a giggle. He sounds like a comic actor, aping a nobleman, rather than a nobleman true. The speaker is tall and stands with one foot forward, a hand on his hip as if posing for a portrait. He wears a coat of blue silk inlaid with gold. The hand that supports his cane, Julie notices, has two fingers missing. So, a duelist or a warrior? No wars for a couple of years now. He must be bored, poor lamb, she thinks. A man like that needs action. She wonders what it would be like to lie with him. Would he just strike poses while she did all the work? She smiles to herself. She knows a few tricks to rattle an icy composure. But she would get nothing back from him, she is sure. And so what? In lifting her skirts for a man like that, she'd be after so much more than a tremble and an O. She'd be seeking a destiny. "This is the street singer," says another man, his voice equally mannered. It is as if he has made scissors of his lips and is trying to clip and trim the words as they emerge. Not that she can see his lips. His face is only that of a leering devil, horns and long nose, a painted mouth of teeth. The first man lifts his hand to his mask.
Let her sing, he says, and let us see if she is, as you claim, Abaddon, God's creation.
The man raises his hand. A splendidly dressed servant, in a powdered wig, turns to a servant who is merely impressively dressed, and raises a finger. That servant turns to a servant who is well-dressed, and he to another who is certainly no scruff, and raises a finger. This servant turns to her and raises a finger of his own.
Now? Says Julie.
The unscruffy servant nods.
Well, by God's bollocks, says Julie, you might have just said so yourself. Oh no. Nerves, the masks, the night, the fog, have conspired to make her forget herself.
God's bollocks,
says one of the devils. He carries a stick of silver and prods it forwards, as if the words are on the ground before him and he is jabbing them to inspect them.
Begging your pardon, it is an expression we use when we're...
The three-fingered gentleman inclines his head.
Who are we?
The people.
The word we should be outlawed, he says. There is no we wide enough to pair me with the likes of you and the mob.
Oh, do fuck off, says Julie. Oh no, the nerves again. They have betrayed her. She wants to smile and nod and be pretty. But from somewhere this defiance has emerged. She curtsies. Begging your pardon, sir. I am inclined to such outbursts when nervous. Think naught of them.
Do they say naught for nothing? She hopes so, and hopes it might make her seem more refined. He inclines his head, studies her as a cat might a spider.
She's a mite coarser than one might have assumed, Diablo.
Her singing bears no mark of it, says one of the masked devils.
Three Fingers raises his hand again, and the chain of command ensures a much lower status hand is raised in front of her to tell her to sing.
Well,
she'll take the evening so far as a success. She has never spoken directly to such a great man before, even if she did tell him to fuck himself. She imagines herself his wife, he away hunting or at war, or poking about in the woods, dressed as a devil. She at the opera, singing in his jewels, in the dresses he might buy, riding home in his gilded carriage, riding the grooms, riding the maids, giving the tall, thin duke some bonny fat children he would have to call his own or face dishonour. She sees herself in black at Versailles, looking out at the fabled lawns, loudly cursing the Spanish or English or whoever's ball of lead so conveniently killed him and left her a rich widow. She would be comforted by some gorgeous duchess, yes, a widow too, and she would fall in love and be loved. She could fuck a man, she could laugh and play and be ever so fond of a man, but she could only ever really love a woman. This fantasy duchess, with her hair in a tower of stolen curls, a shepherd's crook of gold in her hand, little tame lambs in diamond collars to wander behind. Yes, she could love a woman like that, madly. Perhaps Pavel might be there too, as her secret, or not her secret. He could fuck one woman well enough, why not two? She would commission arias just for herself and sing to the golden angels on the ceiling of the opera so well. Those angels would think she was one of them. She has not seen Three Fingers' face, but already she has married him, killed him, and is spending his money becoming...
what?
Great, yes. Great, grand, and beautiful. She is already pretty, but she wants something more.
to have an awing beauty that makes the world her slave. All love. To give and receive love magnificently. Yes, she will become the world's lover and be loved by it, in a mad amour that will lift her to the heavens. Well, a girl can dream, can't she? She clears her throat and begins. These great men will not be charmed by sweetness or by coyness the way a street crowd would. For them, something more sharp, piquant, more challenging. She must sing of love, though, and everything that goes with it. She must stir their blood, stiffen their pricks, and then they are hers, and she can get what she wants from them. She dismisses the song she was going to sing. Instead, she will sing one she heard not weeks ago, after Pavel smuggled her into the opera. She only needs to hear such things once, and then they are lodged in her mind. She will sing The Blood That Unites Me With You, from Lully's great work, Armide. And she will sing both the part of Armide, the enchantress, and her lover, Iradou, her range great enough to accommodate both. She doesn't need the note, doesn't need the harpsichord to bounce her in. She begins, and the wood holds its breath. No bird has ever sung like this. No footpad trilled or haw hummed in such a tone. It is as if something new and strange is being made, coming to birth in the world. A night flower unfurls and offers its inky petals to the moon. Probably, anyway. Somewhere that must be happening, she thinks. She sings of it, which is how the song begins. The gentlemen are statues. Only one paws at the air with his hand, as if it is floating on the melody. She allows a brief silence when the low part is finished, to create a tension, spark desire through denial. And then, Armide herself. She begins. Unaccompanied, there is no wavering, no guess for the note. Can any of the gentlemen believe she has never been trained beyond what a country estate had to offer her? They cannot. The notes tumble from her, so pure, so clear and delicious in the still air of the foggy wood. The conclusion, when it comes, seems torn from her soul. Against my enemies I will unleash the dark empire of hell. Love puts kings under my spell. I am the sovereign mistress of a thousand lovers, but my greatest happiness is to be mistress of my own heart. They are enraptured. They are entranced. There is a long silence. No one speaks, as if the merest chance that this flat fog, these damp trees, might offer an echo of the song's magnificence.
Truly a creation of God, says Three Fingers. A rare talent indeed.
Mwah.
One man makes a kissing gesture to his fingers before snapping them out before him in approval. Another devil just nods furiously before taking out an overlarge snuff box decorated with a dragon, pinching out a mighty nip, shoving it beneath his mask and inhaling it with a snort of delight. She sees a gobful of dark teeth as he casts back his head, and the snuff goes in. A sure sign of wealth. They say it is sugar that makes the teeth go rotten, and who but the very well-off can afford that? Julie's heart skips. With patrons such as these, what things might she aspire to? There would be no limit to her ambition.
She sees herself on stage at the opera, bathed in candlelight, filling that great space with the music that flows through her.
A virginal flower,
says one, a fat man who carries a gilded, finely wrought pistol in his belt.
Let us do what we came for,
says a tall, thin man, who waves a pristine white handkerchief.
Let us sacrifice her and call forward the devil. It is your turn to lead, Bissy,
he says to the little fat man.
Sirs?
Says Julie. She doesn't understand, not at all.
Sacrifice?
What does that mean? If you wrote those words down, passed them to her, and asked her to read, she would know what was meant. But there in the wood, they come as such a shock that she cannot make sense of them. Swords are drawn, the blades shining tongues of fire. Now the words make sense, terrible sense. Julie feels her stomach fall to her feet as she knows she is the victim of an awful trick. She pulls out her hairpin, useless, of course, against these blades. But she will not go down without some sort of fight. A snort of laughter from behind the masks.
Beelzebub, we have paved the way, says Three Fingers. We have spoken your names. We walked the circle widdershins. We have cursed God and his angels.
We spit on the name of Jesus,
shout the men.
We praise the names of Judas and of Satan and of the great whore of Babylon, shouts Three Fingers.
We praise the whore,
the men chorus. They close in on her, like wolves upon a stricken deer, pacing forward slowly, confident their prey cannot escape, their dead-eyed masks fixing her with lethal stares.
Take the virgin, says Three Fingers.
I'm no fucking virgin,
screams Julie. The men pause, as if partway through a dance whose music is frozen.
What?
Says the man with the scissored vowels.
I am no virgin.
The masks turn to each other.
You are a country girl of 16, says a man who twirls his sword, as if he is an idle lover twiddling a stalk of grass at a girl's gate.
And I have not been a virgin these 2 years, says Julie. Sirs, if you seek to kill a pure woman, you will not find one here. There is little to do in the countryside but horizontal pursuits. And once the love of that pastime is secured, there is very little that can shake its habit. Why, the Comte d'Armagnac fat me himself on my 14th birthday, and I was glad to have him.
This is not quite true. The Comte had dragged her to his bed, but he had been so drunk he fell unconscious when he got her there.
You are merely trying to save your skin. You are an untouched girl. You countrywomen, save yourselves, all for one sweating oaf, I know, Three Fingers says.
I don't know, says one devil. They are at it like dogs, from as soon as they are able in my estates in Evreux, with me quite often.
I had a man, not half an hour ago, says Julie, in the carriage that brought me here.
In the carriage here?
I was nervous, you know what they say, sirs, a fuck for luck.
They?
The people, or rather I do. The act is very calming, sirs, and I do believe it enhances the female voice. I sing so well for a reason, sirs, think of that. The contact with men enables my low notes, I'm sure of it.
Her heart is racing. She is speaking the words, but it is as if she is outside her body, looking in. She did not come here to die. She has so much to do.
Is the carriage still here? Says Three Fingers.
It is, says a man in a coat adorned with butterflies, at a distance with the servants.
Go and see if the groom is there.
Why don't we kill her anyway? Says another devil.
It is a matter of how, not when. I have another 200 lines of summoning to get through before we're meant to kill her, says Three Fingers. I can save a lot of effort if I know it will come to no good.
A devil lifts his mask, takes a nip from a bottle of brandy. She sees his face briefly, an eye patch on his right eye, a mess of scars beneath.
Are we required to fuck her for this ceremony? Asks another devil.
Yes.
But not if she's a strumpet, right? My syphilis has gone away and I don't want it back. I will only fuck virgins and my wife. You know that, dear boy.
No need to fuck her. We just kill her.
Excellent. I've just had these breeches made by Dakar. I don't want them stained with mud, says another voice.
She hears a cry from the trees.
Get off me!
And realizes with alarm that it's Pavel. What will these men do to him? If she is to die, must he? She has placed him in great danger and must protect him. He is prodded in at the point of a sword.
Pavel, I lied and said we had fucked in the carriage. Deny it. Sirs, I am a virgin, I admit.
Too late, says the devil with Pavel. He has confessed it already, twice in the carriage and many times before, it seems.
Oh, in the name of Satan, Villepin, do you not check these things before dragging us to the woods for nothing?
She cannot tell who is speaking beneath the masks.
Bring wine,
says Three Fingers loudly to the darkness. Swords are sheathed, and the servants bring wine. One of the devils leers at Pavel, says boo, and the boy shrinks away terrified. She must do something.
Would you like another song, sirs?
She says. All her life she has been able to charm with song.
This one song, why not?
Says a devil. And she does not know what he means. Pavel is glancing from mask to mask, but the devil who grips him still has his sword drawn.
And if I sing well enough, will you let us go?
I might keep you as a servant, says Three Fingers. Who knows?
And my friend?
No one says anything. There is no sound in the woods. The fog muffles everything to silence. Begging will not help her. She knows these to be proud men who expect and respect pride, courage, and arrogance. And so she sings one of Lully's death songs.
Shades, ghosts, companions of death, I do not ask of you, I do not want mercy. I do not complain of this my lot. This exchange I do not call cruel. Shades, ghosts, companions of death, let not such just piety offend you. An unknown force that I feel in my breast gives me courage, spurs me on to the test, makes me greater than myself.
She lets the words babble from her, sweet as a brook, and then burst out, cold and pure as a spring torrent. The men stand rapt, masks tipped back, just enough to allow them to drink the offerings their servants bring, sipping brandy from crystal glasses. All the time, they never take their eyes from her. She sings, sings for her life, for Pavel's life. She goes on from the song to the whole opera, every part, effortlessly transposing the key of the lower parts as the men drink. While she is singing, she is not dying. She does not stumble on the words nor the tune. Such things imprint upon her and need no memorizing, no work to hold them. She lets the music flow through her as the night grows colder, and the men drink
do nothing but drink. Their masks tipped back, easy in their command, their control of Pavel and of her. Pavel is terrified, shaking. She cannot run in her silly shoes and skirts, but Pavel can, and she wants him to. But he is there for her and will not leave her.
I warned you not to love me, she thinks, and now see the good it has done you. Pavel, don't share this fate.
She does not drink, of course. She is not offered a drink. Not beer, not water, not brandy. And after 2 hours, maybe more, it happens. She has sung almost every part, transposed and moved up a register here, down here, but every part. Her voice cracks, and the spell is broken. The chief devil, Three Fingers, shakes himself.
Enchanting, he says, quite enchanting.
He walks up to her, his eyes black pits in his leering mask, and inspects her, as one might a work of art. The blow sparks white light in her head, sends her to the earth as if all the bones were knocked out of her. She hits the ground like a fish smacked onto a slab. He has punched her, she realizes, hard in the face.
Fuck her,
shouts someone. Pavel screams. She looks up. A devil grips him from behind and draws a knife across his throat. Pavel falls, a wound like another great mouth at his throat.
Pavel! Pavel!
She cries out. She is kicked, punched. Two devils have her, but she bites, kicks, and is free. Her head is spinning with the force of the blows, but she fights to regain her senses, blinking, gulping in air.
Bitch!
Another, this one in a much plainer mask than the rest, lunges for her. But the music is in her. She is a dancer, turning aside and letting him stumble over a root, so he lands heavily on his knees.
My silks! My silks!
He cries out, but she steps in behind him and draws his sword from his scabbard.
You will leave me, sirs.
Her heart is pounding. Pavel, is he dead?
Mon faucon, you fool, says a voice. You let a girl take your weapon. We should never have had you along as a prospect.
Three Fingers approaches. She looks up at him. Her senses are scrambled, and he is like a creature from a dream, blurred, an assembly of colours, a wavering flame himself among wavering flames. She is going to black out, wants to black out.
My father taught me the art of defence, sir, she says. You will not find me easy with a sword.
She thinks of her father now. He blessed her as she left to go into the world, thought it a wonderful thing she sought to carry her gifts to the highest stage in Paris. He had always known she would go, he said, right from the time she was small. But he had put a sword in her hand early, taught her the arts of defence, because he knew that a lone woman in the world of Paris would need such a thing. Three Fingers laughs a little laugh, puts his fingers to the lips of his mask like a maiden aunt hearing a saucy story.
This is the best swordsman in France,
says a mocking voice from behind him. Three Fingers flashes his sword like a whip through the torchlight.
If in France, then in the world, says Three Fingers. Put up, fellows, stand back.
She points the sword at him, in line, as her father had told her, arm straight, the point as far from her body as it can be held. Whoever wants to kill her will have to deal with that first.
Oh dear, says Three Fingers. Oh deary dear.
He steps in, and with a squeeze of his fingers, he has beaten the blade aside, extending his arm to offer the merest snick on the fabric of her sleeve with the tip of his blade.
I can take your weapon and make it mine, he says, encircling her blade with his, so it feels it will spin from her fingers.
She regains her grip, straight arm quivering.
I can oppose you, steel to steel.
He shoves his sword forward, angling the hilt wider to deflect her blade, using it to guide his point to its target. Another snick on the sleeve. Her arm is cut and she cries out in pain.
I can ensnare the blade, he says. Bind and cross, transport and deflect, make your arm my arm and move it where I like.
In a whirl, he has caught her sword with his and moves it at will.
A straight arm is a fine defense against a village thug, he says. For me it is a gift, and I give you my best gift in return. Without crosspiece or blade breaker, with no dagger, buckler or cloak, but with only fingers and wrist, I give you the disarm.
In a flick, her sword is out of her hand and flashing through the torchlight. She steps away, but he has trodden on her foot, and unbalanced, she falls to the ground. He has the tip of his sword at her breast, and she cannot move at all.
Had I the surgeon's art, he said, I would cut your throat so nicely that you would not die, but never sing again.
I would rather die, she says.
Well, that's rather the point, he says.
He moves the sword up to her neck.
But what's to lose, he says. If I kill you, I kill you. A risk I shall take. Perhaps a pressure here.
He pushes the sword in under her chin, and she cries out in pain.
Yes, the base of the tongue, that should do it. Indeed, yes.
She screams as the needle blade pierces her flesh, screams up at the blank-eyed mask above her. Warm blood covers her chest. The tip of the sword feels so unnatural, so unwelcome in her throat. A plunk on the back of the white silk glove. A raindrop. The rain comes in across the torchlight, great golden berries from the dark sky, pattering the leaves and the mould. A consternation among the gentlemen. Silk may be ruined, lace muddied, and worse. Those who had stinted on expense in ribbons, pleats, and hats might see colours run, exposing them as cheapskates.
My God, says Three Fingers, this coat is by Boileau of Saint-Germain.
The rain in an instant is awash, a descending veil. He draws back his sword hand, but then puts his free hand up before his eyes. The white glove is stained with the purple dye of his head ribbon.
I'll kill that haberdasher, he says. A cape, gods, a cape!
He turns away and rushes for his coach. She spits at him, spits blood.
You will go to hell for this,
she says, the words agony, bubbling with blood.
This is not my final scene.
She is right. It is, however, the end of her first scene, as a kick from God knows where sends her reeling into darkness as the curtain of the rain falls. Scene 2. Entrance of the Fury.
So soon departed.
She awakes. It is still night, though the rain has gone, and somewhere behind the horizon a milky morning is trying to be born. The taste of blood is in her mouth. She tries to breathe through her nose, but it is blocked, maybe broken. Her arms feel wrenched and pulled, her legs numb where she has been kicked and stamped on. She puts a hand to her throat. It's agony. Her voice. She tries a note, a simple ah, but there is too much pain, and she coughs herself raw. Blood is streaming over her fingers, and she tears a piece of her ripped sleeve to stem the flow.
He has ruined me,
she croaks.
Ruined me. Pavel.
She must find him, see if he has survived.
This is irregular. This is insulting. This will not do.
Someone else is there. The voice is musical, the vowels like an oboe, the consonants crashing like timpani. Her head is disordered. Is she dead? She does not know. She coughs again, spits out blood, crawls forward, or tries to, while holding the cloth to her neck.
tries to look for Pavel. It is cold and the ground is filthy. Her hand slips on the mud.
Pavel,
she says.
Dead, says the voice. Murdered.
A great wail rises inside her, but it does not find expression in voice. Instead, she grunts, low like an animal, like a mastiff thrown down by the bull, but preparing for another attack.
The devil take them,
she says, but her voice is guttural, shredded. It's as if the sword is still stuck in her throat. She wants to die. If her throat is ruined for good, then her life is over. She is near to crying, though she has never cried. She was not made for it. The voice continues.
Well, the problem is they'll all be shriven before morning. Roll into church, confess their sins, a couple of Hail Marys and they're white as snow, ready to do it all again, safe from hell. It does not seem right. They are too rude to call a ruler, a potentate, a grand and royal personage of a most noble domain, from princely works and then to depart before they arrive. An egregious lapse of manners, don't you agree?
Only now does she see the man in front of her, and at first she mistakes him for one of her tormentors. He is so finely dressed, the slim sword he twiddles in his fingers so well wrought, so light and quick. But is it even a man? If it is a man, it is a young one, so dainty and pretty that he might be a girl. Only his voice, low like hers, says he might be a male. The hands on which rubies flame are pale and long like a woman's. The figure wears a coat of shining gold, laced and decorated in blue sapphires, and adorned with a brooch of golden angel's wings. The breeches are palest primrose. The shoes... there are no shoes. Instead, where the shoes should be, are a pair of shining black hooves.
I know you, sir, madam,
she says. She tries to get up, levers herself onto her hands and knees.
All men know me, all women too.
You are Lucifer.
Her throat makes speaking agony, though she feels she must talk.
Yes, lately. Though I have many names, Ishtar and Astarte, goddess of the dawn, Venus and Aphrodite, lady of pleasures, whose number is 666. And yes, Satan. Of course, now they call me the devil, king of hell, and queen.
You are a woman.
We are all women sometimes, says the devil, if we've got anything about us. Man, woman, other things too. I am legion. Sometimes I wonder if I'm even one person or one thing.
The devil takes her hand. Her arm cannot be broken, as she thought, for there is no pain. Instead, a strange tingle spreads throughout her body. His, her, their hand is hot, very hot, but not unbearable. She stands. She doesn't know how.
If you are the devil, then I am dead, she says.
She shivers. I thought hell would be warmer.
No, says Lucifer, you are not dead, though you are grievously injured. I think you will recover. But you risk rudeness yourself to concentrate on your own minor problems, when mine are so much greater.
She retches blood. The world wobbles on its axis. It never felt more like a globe. She feels she could slide off.
I am waiting, says Lucifer, for you to express some concern about me.
Julie wipes the blood from her mouth, dizzy. All of her life, she has dreamed of having access to powerful men, to bend them to her will. Now, though she may be delirious, may be reeling from her beating, she is before the second most powerful being in creation. She had thought a great deal on how to approach this sort of wealthy and important person. Flattery. No one is immune.
"You are certainly the injured party here," she says, coughing.
"I am indeed. I am not used to being called like a dog and then left out in the cold. Not used at all. They called me, imagined that they summoned me as if I could be compelled by such as they in any way. They simply descended to a level of depravity that sparked my interest, and I chose to come. Then they abandoned me."
"Rude. Rude, grievous rude." "Will you let me help you?"
she says. There is a whistle in her voice.
"How?"
She doesn't know, so she just says,
"I could sing for you."
She retches. Blood, blood, blood. She cannot sing now, she is sure. Her throat is raw, her head spinning, but it is all she knows. What else can she offer the devil but the gift God gave her?
"Not necessary," says the devil. "Your voice is beautiful, but reminds me too much of the angels. I miss heaven and would not wish to be melancholy."
"Then what can I do?"
"Well, you're not going to be of much use down there feeling sorry for yourself. You have much to work with. You have many of the seven diabolic virtues, but not all. You are lustful, you are proud, you do not envy, though you do want greatly. But you are greedy for all life has to offer, all the riches, all the gain, all the experience. You are not slothful. No one could call you lazy and contented. And you are not a glutton, but..."
Now Julie sees. There on the wet ground in the pale light of the pre-dawn lies the body of Pavel.
"Wrath," she says. "I have wrath."
The word is like a heat coming from her.
"Yes," says the devil. "Yes, you do. It is..."
The devil sniffs. Scent, the air.
"It is delicious. Palpable."
Lucifer explodes the consonants of the final word like fireworks popping at a fete.
"Then, sir, let me help you take your revenge on them."
"Madam, I am a lady tonight."
"Then, madam, let me help you."
"I don't need your help, you mad bitch."
The devil is suddenly angry, and that anger seems to shake the ground beneath Julie's feet.
"Well, you just said you fucking did."
Speaking is agony. Julie holds the cloth of her sleeve to her throat, the previous rag being quite soaked. The devil takes a pace back, raises a delicate brow.
"Sorry, sir, madam, Mr. Lady," says Julie. "I am prone to such unfortunate outbursts."
Lucifer says nothing but studies her. Julie bows her head.
"So, you will kill them?"
The devil mulls.
"That is problematical."
"Why?"
she croaks.
"You are the Dark One, Prince of the Darkened Air. You have stood before Christ unblinking, fought angels. Why can't you kill ordinary men?"
The devil preens, twirling their flashing sword.
"Well, if they are killed by me, God's enemy, that makes them God's friend. So they go to heaven when they die. Lamentable, but as I think will be clear to most, I don't set the rules."
Julie looks at Pavel's body.
"Then let me send them to you. Let me be your instrument," she says.
her voice like a barrel scraping on flagstones. Lucifer shrugs, paces, the black hooves digging up the soft earth.
What do you want to do?
Humiliate them.
The devil smiles.
Yes.
Corrupt everything that is dear to them.
Yes.
And kill them.
Naturally, naturally. But how?
Some of these great men have enemies by the score, and still live confident of seeing the next dawn. How? They have great protectors, fierce bodyguards, men who kill for a living. That one who wounded you is a rare swordsman, though not as rare as he believes, and his skill is that of the practice salle, not the dueling ground. How would you get close enough to kill them? Do you even know who they are?
No. Don't you?
Well, they do wear masks. The devil gives an extravagant shrug.
But
she does not want to question them, him, undermine their authority, but she is beginning to think this fiend is half mad. The devil laughs.
Of course I know who they are, of course. But if I send you, then you are my servant, and again we risk them ending up in heaven. You need to find them. You need to work independently. You need to find a way to be the agent of their perdition.
The word perdition sizzles like bacon in a pan. The light is coming from behind the eastern clouds now, and the woods awake in birdsong. Her pain seems sharper, more unbearable in the light, as if the dark hid it. Never mind, she will go on.
I remember,
she says.
One wears a coat with a heart upon it. Another is called Diabolo. At least one has seen me perform in the street. I heard them called by three names, Bissy, Montfaucon, and Villepin.
The devil holds up a hand to stop her and passes her a black card.
Use your hairpin. Scratch the details there.
She does, though her mind is hazy, her vision blurred. Bissy, who she thinks carries a dragon snuff box. Villepin. Montfaucon. One eye, three fingers, scissor mouth, silver cane, emerald ring, one with a heart upon his coat, another with the waddled step, another short and stout, one called Diabolo, one more with roses on his shoes. These are small things and little to go on, but she writes them down anyway. 13 little seeds she hopes to water with blood.
This is splendid, says Lucifer. This is a traditional arrangement, the like of which has been all too rare recently. Of course, there has to be a price. I mean, you don't get to join in my revenge for nothing.
Nor you, mine, where I come from. Prices are paid in the expectation of return, says Julie, in goods or boons. You will not give me their names, so what have you to offer me, Mr. Madam Matey Boy?
She coughs. Oh dear, she has let her tongue run away with her again. The air seems to chill. The devil snarls, and Julie is suddenly very aware of the pointed white teeth beneath those ruby lips. She's spoken without thinking, forgotten her place. Her father always said her temper would get her into trouble. The devil's face relaxes into a smile.
I'm afraid that if you ask for the usual, you'll just end up losing all motivation.
What usual?
Riches mainly, immortality.
The fiend yawns the last word out.
There are immortals?
Some such miserable souls exist, yes. You don't want that, do you? It's really just turning your world here into hell.
No, I don't.
So what do you want?
Give me back my voice first.
The devil rolls their eyes.
I don't do healing. That's God's province. Ask him. Ask me for something else.
She thinks of how Three Fingers took the sword from her. She does not intend to give her enemies the chance to fight back, but if they do, she needs to be prepared. She knows now what she will ask.
I heard a tale that you taught someone to play the violin once.
I did. I will. Music is in my gift. Is that what you'd like? I don't see how it would hasten your revenge.
I have music. I don't need yours if you cannot heal me. No. I want you to teach me to fence. I have a little skill already, but I want to learn properly. Can you do that?
Lucifer bows and slashes at the air with their fine sword.
There is no student of the sword like me. No one who can know better the use of finger and foot, the subtle disengage, the secret thrusts, the dropping soft step, the long overhand thrust or the pass in four. No one can fence like me.
The devil illustrates the words by stepping daintily, by thrusting and cutting, turning and dropping, all the time the movements as fine and measured as a court dancer.
But can you teach?
Of course. I am a rare instructor, a professor non pareil. All the books agree on that.
So, teach me.
Why not just learn to kill? I could show you poisons. I could show you traps. I could show you how to lead a man to damnation with powders sweet, tinctures bitter, leaves to chew and smoke and spit. Go to Pommes, the apothecary. He does my work, though he knows it not.
Death is not enough. I will find these men, and I will, by guile and wile, send their souls to hell.
No,
says the devil, twirling the fine sword, this time so quick the blade leaves flashes in the dawn air.
No. Think, why not? Because I am a woman?
Because you haven't got a sword.
I will.
What? Buy one? With what? Fairy gold, a song? That's a lot of singing to buy a good dueling blade. Even if you can sing, that's a nasty wound, by the way. I would get it seen to.
Julie growls again, her mastiff growl.
I will find the first. I'll kill him myself and send him to you, and I will take his sword. After that, you will teach me.
The devil smiles. She can see this idea pleases him, them, her, whatever.
A murderer binds you to me and shows good faith. After that, I will teach you. One lesson for each death. You will need to be a rare fencer to best some of these fellows.
One for each.
Yes. But let us set a limit. I like you, and it would be sweet to show you the agonies of hell. I will teach you, but you have a year to kill all 13. If, by midnight, All Hallows' Eve, the last one does not lie cold and unshriven in his grave, I will take you, lady, alive to hell.
Julie bows her head, glances at Pavel's cold body. He died. After fucking out of wedlock, he will go to hell.
Do you have his soul?
She says.
I do.
Then release him until our bargain is done and we have a deal.
The devil considers, seems uncertain.
All of them, says Julie, in a year. That is no easy task.
And you will not confess the murders before a priest, before all are gone?
I will not.
Then let's make it traditional. Midnight on October the 31st, a year from now.
Midnight, she says. Let me see Pavel is free.
Oh, very well. I grant you ghost sight. The devil waves a hand, and Judy sees Pavel's ghost, pale and insubstantial, wandering dazed about the forest.
Pavel,
she says. He has just been released from hell, says Lucifer. It will take a while for him to come to his senses. Do we have a deal?
We do.
The devil smiles and bites their own pretty lips until blood shows. Julie knows what to do, coming forward to kiss the fiend with her own bloody mouth, pressing her bruised lips to Lucifer's, mingling blood. A sensation of crackling fire goes through her, the smell of cinders, cinnamon, everything burned and beautiful. And then she is alone, in the lightening wood, cold and shivering, only a black card in her hand. She goes to Pavel's body, casts her arms around him, holds him, cold, to her breast. A bird sings, and the sound of its voice is unbearable to her. Too sweet, too much a reminder of what she has lost. She lowers Pavel to the earth and runs for the town, for the opera, to tell Archon to bring a hearse for her dead lover. And as she clasps her ruined throat, she vows she will make a hearse of the bones of the Tredicem for the corpse of her voice, and she will drive it to hell.
Scene 3. Butterfly, shed thy wings.
She runs towards the sound of the tolling bells that welcome in the new day, unimpeded through the gate of the Bois. The gateman mistakes her for a whore, and having paid a bribe to get in, she is not required to pay one on the way out. She has no money on her. And the few fiacres, the cabs for hire, that are by the Bois at this hour, would not take her anyway for fear she would bleed on their seats. She pauses, tries to find her way, shivers. The sun of autumn has a cold stare, looking on creation with contempt from its own pale splendour. She hates the sun now, for it exposes her fall. She is changing, she feels, from a creature of the light to one of the dark. She longs for the darkness, not so she can hide and be safe, but to hide and be dangerous. Then she is running again, still holding the rag to her throat. What damage has he done? She should stop at the Université for help, but she has heard the doctors there do as much harm as good. She runs through the patchy field between the Bois and the town, through the smell of morning fires, of burning rubbish, of the shit of pigs and of pig herds, of the wet and warming land. As she nears the buildings at the edge of Paris, she winds through kitchen gardens, the stink of the city already sweeping over her. Rot and decay, so unlike the autumn of the woods. In the woods and fields, things decay because they are meant to. Leaves, flowers, the bodies and leavings of animals. And so the decay promises renewal. In Paris, things rot that should not decay. People, hopes, love, kindness, souls. An endless autumn heading towards winter with no prospect of renewal. The smoke of a fire drifts past, acrid and bitter. What are they burning? Perhaps better not to ask. She hurries on. A ragged woman, carrying two pails of water on a pole across her shoulders, looks at her and shakes her head in pity or disgust, Julie cannot tell, and does not care. Houses spring up,
and the streets wind through them like mould through a stinking cheese. And then Julie sees her, coming the other way. Another woman of about her age. She is poor. No one rich is that thin. But she has on a good blue dress, and in her hand she clutches a bonnet set with flowers. For an instant she almost thinks it is herself she sees, a spectre of herself conjured by tiredness, by her rattling headache, by anguish. But it is not. The girl's nose is broken, and blood streams down her chin onto the front of the white trim, where the cloth has been pricked in imitation of lace. She is crying. The girl stops as she sees Julie. Her eyes widen. Julie walks up to her. Julie wants to ask what happened to her, to find out if she has suffered at the hands of these horrible men too. But she is exhausted from running, and her throat is agony. She cannot summon the strength to speak. The woman's face hardens, her eyes narrow.
"Bitch,"
she says, the word like a whip crack.
"This is my patch, my patch."
And then she slaps Julie hard across the face.
"I see you here again, I'll kill you,"
she says, and moves on, crying again. Julie looks up to the heavens, though she expects no help from that direction. She is ragged, she is filthy, and she is bleeding. Though none of those conditions mark her as unusual in this teeming city of 500,000 souls, where it is said 1 in every 10 is a beggar. For every beaten girl with a bloody rag at her throat, there are 100 more, men, women, and children, feigning distress, injury, illness, and disease, to pluck the heartstrings of the rich or not so rich, and to be given alms. She stands, shocked by the slap for an instant. But nothing can hurt her more. A dizzy, disordered feeling comes up inside her. She senses what it might be like to cry, though she has not cried since she was a small child. The girl was not a cheat, she thinks. She was not feigning distress, she is distressed. Anyone who finds themselves weeping for alms in the street is not going back to a golden apartment on the Ile de la Cité in the afternoon. She goes on down the Grand Cour, a wide avenue. At least she will not have to risk the back streets as she runs. Still runs, under the pale gold of the parade of autumn elms. She is not tired, she is possessed. She sweeps past the poor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.